Hola, it's Finn. Today we're in Chicago at Phonak US headquarters, and we're going to meet with Steve, who works at Park. He's going to explain some of the amazing hearing aids available on the market today and some of the amazing features on this first episode.
Hi, Finn.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well. My name's Steve. I'm an audiology manager at Phonak. Started a few months ago, but I'm very interested to hear all about some of your experiences, and I'd like to hear more and more about how the hearing aids are working for you and that sort of thing.
Yeah, so I started using the Phonak Marvels not too long ago, and I was just wondering, like, what makes them so much different from the other hearing aids that have been going through the past generations?
Yeah, sure. So within the hearing aids, there's been a lot of new developments. So first of all, there's a new chip. It's called a SWORD chip, actually, which is an acronym. It stands for something. But it's one of the most advanced chipsets that's available on the market today. So from previous hearing aids, you know, they always work really well, you know, given some of the context that those things are developed in. But one of the biggest advancements for the Marvel is that this new chip is out there, allowing for faster processing times, more computations per minute, that sort of thing. So it takes all of the little bits that go into hearing and just elevates the whole process. So that's probably the biggest advancement.
So how exactly, you know, this a lot of people don't know, but how does a hearing aid work? Like, what do they go through to get to your canals?
Yeah, well, there's basically four parts to any hearing aid. So there's a microphone, then there's the amplifier, which is that chipset that we're talking about, and then there's a receiver, which is a fancy word for a loudspeaker, just like on your car stereo or if you go to see a band play or something like that. And then the last part is the battery. It's the thing that gives it all power, right?
Yep.
So sound will come in through the microphone, just like when you're talking at a lecture or something like that. It'll be processed by that amplifier to be made louder, and all of that is based off of computations of what somebody's hearing curves look like and that kind of stuff. And then it's reproduced into the speaker and then sent to the ear canal. What we want to do with the processing is try to make it natural so
exactly.
That it doesn't sound like reproduced or weird or strange.
That's what something that, like, I noticed with these Marvels is they sound like it's real life. The old one sounded like, you know, everything was just loud. But now it's like, when you put these on, it's instantaneous. Whoa, that's like, it feels real.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm actually talking to that person.
Exactly. And those are all those, so the chip itself is actually incredibly complicated with all of the different processing things that go into it. So it'll be able to identify things that are speech and noise. Oftentimes it'll be able to tell where it's coming from. And so when you, as you said, everything is perceived as being just loud if it's just turned up. You know,
exactly.
So now the amplifiers are so sophisticated that they can tell what things to pop up, what things to turn down, so that it has that real life experience.
So what exactly makes Phonak hearing aids so differently with things such as like the auto sense programs and the actively like changing situation for each hearing aid?
The things that make a Phonak hearing aid unique, and one of the ones that you touched on specifically was auto sense. So let's spend a couple minutes there. I think one of the things from my perspective as an audiologist that really makes it awesome and unique is that I can go in there and program certain things for you so that you can, at a push of a button, get to it, you know, which is fine. That's a very nice way of doing it, but it requires you to go up and press the button.
Yep.
But the cool thing about AutoSense is that, like, let's say we settled on something in an office and you said, oh, I really like the way that it sounds there. With AutoSense, we can set it up so that when you get into an environment that matches those characteristics, it'll switch over to that. And it'll blend it in more or less automatically without you having to press any of those buttons. Now, let's say, for example, it didn't get there or it didn't get there fast enough or it wasn't quite right. You could still then use the button and do it. So from my perspective, it's one of those things. It's like that perfect balance between automation and then control when you need it, you know. And to me, that's what sets Phonak apart, you know, as one of the greatest hearing aids that's available today.
So there's an active AI in every hearing aid now, basically?
Yeah, you can think about it that way. There's some intelligence that's built in, so like, and it's actually a little bit simple if you think about it, because number one is it'll be able to detect how loud a signal is. So my voice has certain characteristics to it. There's a loudness aspect to it, and then it kind of starts and stops.
Yeah.
So unlike, say, an air conditioner in the background that just goes all the time, that has a specific acoustic signature too, in that it doesn't change, it has kind of the same frequency content. If I start to shout, or if I sing a song, or do some kind of inflection to a voice, it'll have all of those characteristics, and the hearing aid will be able to say, oh, that's somebody talking.
So it's more like, if this isn't met, then we need to do this.
Exactly.
Instead of looking for certain things right now.
Right.
But right now, it's better. It wants to meet the goals that are set by each audiogram specifically.
Mm-hmm.
That's
mm-hmm.
why they say you have to be fine-tuned to every single person.
Exactly. Right. So you've got that. And then, on top of it, all of the different classification things, that's a little bit like your AI intelligence,
yeah.
right? Because it has some memory up here, and it says, okay, if I hear this thing, I need to do some kind of behavior as a result of it. And in that way, it does have this sort of artificial intelligence component to it.
So how do you work in a lab to figure out these features that are going to work in the real world?
Yeah, that's a great question. First of all, there's a lot of things that are done in a simulation. So before we even get to the point of putting it on somebody's ears to try them out, and well before they get released for as a product or something like
yeah.
that, we start looking at simulations that are based off of what people tell us that they think they need or that they want, or what they believe that they will make their hearing experience better. So we always start, sort of the theme is start with the user, start with the person that's wearing the device. Get a feel for what their pain points are, what their needs are, and then start to simulate that a little bit from a computer program or something like that, so that we can say, all right, so say for example, hearing and noise.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of these things that is always driving the industry to start to get better and better, because it's one of the most challenging listening situations
exactly.
that everybody talks about. And it could be, you know, noise could be kids in school. It could be going out to restaurants with loved ones and all that kind of stuff. So we have to think a little bit about, all right, so what does hearing and noise mean for a kid in school versus somebody going to the restaurant? What's the difference between those two
yep.
environments? Because there are
a lot of different
things going on.
Kids screaming in the background compared to dishes clattering on the floor.
Exactly, exactly. So then, you know, we take a look, and there's a lot of different ways that you can approach it. Is it something, the way that the hearing aid sits on the ear? Can that be optimized to make the signal reception be better, you know, before it even gets into the hearing aid? So you can use sort of those mechanical things with the way that a hearing aid is designed. And those things are usually simulated, and then some kind of model is built, and then we go through different types of testing and things like sound booths and stuff
yeah.
like that, where we'll make recordings of the hearing aids. We'll do some benchmark tests to see, are they performing better than our previous technologies? Are they competitive across the marketplace? And then from there, we'll start to, you know, hone it into a final product. And then we go through different levels of testing internally to figure out, like, okay, is this, what's the feedback on it? So if just this little piece works in isolation, hey, that's great, but how does the whole
yeah.
system come together as a complete product? And so then we start, you know, trialing them on people's ears, so they'll go out into the real world, they'll use them, they'll get a feel for what it sounds like in certain environments and stuff like that. And then, and as we're getting feedback about it, we're continuously developing as we work up to a milestone target. So like, okay, these guys are ready for prime time, they're ready to be go out in the real world, and then they become the next great hearing
yeah.
aid.
Let's say the Marvels, for example.
Mm-hmm.
You took those in, let's say you mentioned the dummy booth, the hearing
mm-hmm.
booth. So
mm-hmm.
that's like an audiologist, you know, like an audiologist's office. You're in the hearing booth, I'm guessing at a bigger scale.
Mm-hmm.
But you're in there, and basically you're just listening to recordings of how those hearing aids work in those situations.
Yep.
So that'd be like the very basic.
And yes, exactly. And that's like just sort of a corner of it, right?
Yep.
So that's like getting some expert listeners to listen to it and say, like, oh, that sounds good, that sounds bad. And sounding good or bad is always very subjective, because there's
yeah.
things about performance, you know. Sometimes it has to sound like, say for example, hearing a noise, is if you go into an environment and you take away all the noise, that's gonna sound unnatural. Somebody
yeah.
might listen to it and say, it's bad. And then all of a sudden you decide, oh, I'm not gonna develop that because somebody said it was bad. And in reality, it was probably the best possible thing, because even though it sounds a little weird, it gets rid of all the background noise. So there's
yeah.
this kind of balancing act that goes on. Does that make some sense?
Exactly. It's also different because people that have normal hearing can understand that those situations
mm-hmm.
compared to someone like me that can't understand those situations. I
right.
might prefer not to have that background.
Exactly.
So it's very subjective. That's where like fine tuning, of course, comes in. Awesome. So with the different hearing aids that Phonak offers, like the pediatric and the adult versions, what exactly is the difference in terms of auto sense and stuff like that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, auto sense for pediatrics is different in that it was developed with some specific research that looked at a child's day, for example. So when you're at school, you're going into a lot of different environments, and again, we're looking at kind of kids from a broad bucket, so to speak. So, you know, maybe kindergarten kids all the way up to high schoolers and stuff like that. So those days are very different, and if you're in the mindset of kind of the younger age group, think about, you know, cast your mind back a few years and go to what it was like when you were in kindergarten or first grade or something like that. You were moving from different things like, you know, recess.
Yep.
And then you went to, you know, math class or whatever it is, then into social studies. Then maybe you had lunch and then you had to do some group work or something like that. Well, each one of those has a very different environment, right? Because like one of them is going to have maybe a single teacher that's just speaking to you. And that kind of has a acoustic quality that you can manage using certain pieces of technology and stuff like that. When you go into the yelling situations, you know, like recess and group work and stuff, it's a whole different ball
game.
And
you're listening for that single whistle or the single yell.
Exactly.
Like
exactly. So the so a broad-based classifier for, you say, an adult population is going to be designed to kind of be able to differentiate things like a single talker, some static background noise, some other characteristics like that. So there was some development that went on to be able to look at some of those acoustic cues in those different environments and be able to classify them more effectively for kids. So in essence, that's the main difference between AutoSense for kids and AutoSense for adults, is how well it's able to differentiate between a lot of those super active environments like, you know, kids yelling and stuff like that.
So on top of already like being able to determine different differences in each one, now it's determining kids and adults.
Yes.
On top of that.
So yeah, you can think about it that way. Yeah, absolutely.
Very in-depth, the way they look at it. It's unique to each aspect of it.
Yes.
What makes it so different.
Yes, absolutely. All right, Finn, great to meet you. Thanks for sharing some of your time with me today.
You as well. Thank you very much for, you know, sharing all your insights and your knowledge you have in this awesome technology.
Absolutely. I'm so glad that you're enjoying the marvel, and I'm looking forward to seeing you again in the future and talking about all the great developments that we have to come.
Absolutely.